Doctor, doctor, you've helped so many poor, helpless monsters. Why, Dracula's now a professional gardener.
Blech.
Oh, and King Kong and Godzilla are plush toys. And you even got Leonardo DiCaprio to win his very first Academy Award. Is there anything you can't do? Anyone you can't help?
But of course, Nurse Quasimoda.
What is it?
I can't save myself!
Tell me about it.
Welcome to Monster Vlogs. I'm Charlie.
I'm Haley.
Why? It's the last Dracula movie, man. Why did it have to suck?
Because that's what vampires do.
I understand that, but...
We watched House of Dracula. Otherwise known as Monster MD.
Monster Cure MD. Or yep. Monster Demonsterizer MD. Starring, let's go through the... Lon Chaney Jr. once again as Lawrence Talbot, a.k.a. the Wolfman.
John Carradine is...
As Dracula.
As Dracula. Some extra as Frankenstein's monster.
Like, his name is like something. But,
Couple, more than one girl.
Yeah.
That's good.
One of them's a hunchback.
Mm-hmm.
A hunchback that dies?
I think so. She is at least sympathetic. Very sympathetic hunchback.
Yeah.
It's a girl this time.
Yeah.
And when women have physical infirmities, it's something to pity. And fix, apparently.
Yeah. At least with more urgency than, you know, the freaking lackey from House of Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm. And the scientist, who started out very, very good, like, he was curing people all over the place.
Curing people all over the place. He's known for, like, performing medical miracles on some of these folks. And then, who of all people, or monsters, struts into his place at 5 o'clock in the morning, then
Count Dracula. Which I was ready to call bullshit on very early, because, you know, have reluctant vampires in your vampire stuff. That's fine. Dracula is not a reluctant vampire. He is dead and loving it, just like Leslie Nielsen said.
I mean, because he starts out, like, wanting to get rid of his vampirism, but as it goes on, he just falls into, like, all the trappings of it.
But see, like, the very beginning is Dracula creeping on this chick who's sleeping in her room, and he's outside the window, like...
A lot of good extreme close-ups on him. I will give it that.
But I think he was just doing that to get closer to the chick. Like, he didn't really want to cure his vampirism. He just said he did. So I think the whole curing the vampirism was a ruse.
It was a ruse. And once again, the Frankenstein monster is being used as the end game, but only in the last 5 minutes.
Like, they just happened to find him in the mud of a sea cave.
It's like, oh... Oh, that's the Frankenstein monster, and that's
with
the
skeleton.
With the skeleton, because that's the doctor.
Karloff's character from last time.
Because that's the doctor who tried to resurrect him. Okay, and then they leave.
Like, we're just gonna sit here on a Chekhov's slab here, set him up for later.
And then the doctor tries to resurrect him, his assistants talk some sense into him. You're like, what are you doing? He's gonna, like, you idiot, like, you should be performing these miracles for all of mankind. I'm like, this is mankind. I thought we established that. Like, removing the fact that he turns into a mad scientist, spoilers, he turns into a mad scientist, like, we've established in the previous films that though he was created artificially, he is still very much human.
Human. Though I will say that my little in story thing is that he has been fried back to life and then killed in so many various ways the frontal part of his brain is pretty much gone.
Okay.
So there's not... Because we get so little time with the monster awake in both this one and House of Frankenstein that, like, he only has enough time to imprint on the person that woke him up and get mad because that person died.
Yeah.
Like, he's a little baby duckling that's huge. And at that point, like, you know, it was just like, I'd love to sit here and reason with you, but you've clearly backed the wrong horse.
And then Talbot's in here.
And Talbot comes looking for a cure for his werewolfism.
Again.
Again.
But this time it actually works.
This time it works!
Because of spores.
Because of mold that softens bone and helps his brain increase in size. And
yeah,
cures his werewolfism. Like, it's so silly and stupid, but dang it, we've been following poor Lawrence for so many movies now. It's nice to have him finally enjoy a night sky.
Well, for this movie.
For this movie. Shut up. I have hope.
Remember, we still have Abbott Costello meet Frankenstein.
That's technically a parody. That's technically a parody. In this continuity, he gets a happy ending with a nice nurse chick. And
The nice nurse chick who was falling under the spell of Dracula, which I'll say was a pretty effective scene.
It kind of mirrors the scene in Dracula's Daughter.
A little bit. That's why I liked it.
Where they're playing the piano.
That's why I liked it so much. Because here she is, like, he enters the room as she's playing the Moonlight Sonata
by Beethoven,
on
which is
piano.
A bugger to play, may I say, from a pianist standpoint.
And he walks in and talks to her, and all of a sudden she starts going into this atonal,
like strange modern piece. Thing and
he's like,
I've never heard this before, but I'm playing it.
That is the music of my people. That is where I came from. I'm so
allow me to show you my cultural debts.
This is the music. This is the music of my people.
This is the vampire. This is the vampire chicken dance. The bat dance.
The bat dance. The bat dance.
Flap, 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 flap.
That's the title, Bat Dance in the House of Dracula. But then she pulls out her crucifix and it transitions beautifully.
Seamlessly back into
the Moonlight Sonata. It is one of the best scenes in this movie.
It's a really
movie.
Good scene. I also liked...
The mad scientist's little freak-out transformation.
Because he's using transfusions from himself to try and cure Dracula's vampirism, and after Dracula dies, he's basically infected with evil vampire blood disease and becomes a mad scientist in this trippy, like, dream state.
Yeah.
And it's really interesting to see the most authoritative male character get that anguish and distress. It's something we haven't seen since Bride of Frankenstein.
Yeah.
Like, we haven't seen that here's the person you respect most. We're gonna drag him through the mud.
Yeah, because that was what happened with Colin Clive the whole time.
Right.
So motorcycle.
I also like the scene where the moon's coming up and Lawrence is just standing out in the yard, like,
after his procedure.
After the procedure. Like, it's
just to,
it's
like,
almost...
prove this procedure.
Especially
worked.
If you've just been, we've, like us, watched the movies, been through it with them. It's like, work, 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 work. Let the man be happy. He's so sad.
And he is for once. And then he kills the Frankenstein monster. No, he kills the mad scientist.
He kills the mad scientist. Fire kills the Frankenstein monster.
Again. But does it really? Does it really?
Don't know. We can only hope. Whatever guy plays the scientist, he does a good job of being both that very responsible, authoritarian, like, I'm going to fix you kind of doctor, and then, like, effortlessly segueing into the mad scientist.
Yeah, it's like... But that's the main problem that we have with this movie, is that it feels more like a really downplayed medical drama.
It kind of does.
Because it's like a monster clinic. Like, oh, what ails you? Okay, I'll fix you. Oh, you have parasites in your blood, Count Dracula. Let's fix that by doing transfusions. Oh, Mr. Talbot, your werewolfism is all in your brain.
Pressure
on the brain, which like increases endorphins
and
hormones.
Does
nothing supernatural exist in this world?
It does, but apparently it can be explained away with mad science.
That's how you know we're coming to the end of the atomic age. Because now I
end
think
of the gothic end age into the atomic age.
Because now, I mean, this movie came out in 1945, so it was like the year the war ended.
Mm-hmm.
So, yay for that. The next movie we have out of war, our first out of wartime film.
Was this before or after the bomb dropped?
I don't know. It was probably before, but I'll have to fact check. So, I mean, the pacing is horrendous too.
It doesn't feel like one cohesive story. It feels like a bunch of little narratives. It would have made a great miniseries after the rise of television.
The Monster Clinic.
Yeah, it would have been a wonderful early soap opera with no sex.
Monster Mash. M-A-S-H.
Logo.
There you go.
That's fun. I do like how, even though all the three monsters have basically separate stories from each other, each one did affect the other. Like, Dracula wasn't just shooed out of the way in the beginning, like last time in House of Frankenstein.
It affected the mad scientist.
It affected the scientist, and it affected, like, everyone from then on out.
Right.
It wasn't just one separate film from the other.
Yeah, and then the Frankenstein monster played into
Lawrence's case. And like the Frankenstein's monster just sat on the slab the whole time, and the doctor, after he went mad, tried to resuscitate him a couple times, and it just kept like nee, in the background, waiting for a climax to happen. So
I don't want to think about Frankenstein's climax, okay? I really don't. Zap.
Zap.
Mop.
There is the one scene where mad scientist Hyde, and he's talking to the guy. It's like Dr. Jekyll and Mad Scientist Hyde. He's on the carriage.
That's a really effective scene.
Yeah, he sneaks onto this carriage, this guy that's trying to get to the village.
Are you afraid of me, Siegfried? You're going to tell the police about me, Siegfried. Siegfried!
And it's this really tense moment, and those horses keep going faster. There were lots of good individual scenes in this.
But, I mean, those don't a good movie make.
No, but it at least passes the time well.
Did it really, though? I mean, we just put on a movie and sat through it for 1 hour and 6 minutes. This movie wasn't even like 1.5 hours long, but it felt it. Because the pacing, with all these individual stories happening, like one right after the other, and having to all resolve themselves at the end, some a little prematurely, cough, cough, Dracula cough, it felt a lot longer than it did.
I did like Nina, the girl hunchback, though. She was kind of the whole voice of reason in the thing.
She was kind of like the other guy, but the other guy kind of had the Twitter-pated youngin' stupids happen to him.
Yeah. And she was very... The scientist, I think, was a little bit Twitter-pated in her, because he kept wanting to fix her.
Yeah, I mean, there was...
Which can be as much like he wanted to, like, it was affecting her locomotion, so...
They did kind of clue the audience into that when he was going through his, like, whole mental transformation into, I guess... You know, if you're really stretching, you can call the mad scientist Jekyll and Hyde.
Yeah.
So, in his transformation to Hyde, it was... They did, like, show the scene where it's like has her on the operating table and all of a sudden she can stand up straight and she's in this really beautiful, gorgeous gown. Probably designed by Vera West. We haven't talked about Vera West's style in this entire series.
No, but it's very evident because she's been doing it since the 30s.
Yeah. Vera West is like the gowns maker
for all of these movies.
Like, you gotta pay attention to the behind-the-scenes stuff every once in a while. Mm-hmm. Just all the other stuff that goes into the monster movies. But,
yeah.
I mean, by this point, it really wasn't so much about, like, the makeup. Even though Jack Pierce did come back, it wasn't about the gown making. It wasn't about the costume design or even the set design. Because the set design for the lab was pretty standard.
Yeah.
Even from the... I think they used the same set.
I was a little impressed with the sea cave thing.
Oh, yeah. That was pretty cool. That would have made such a more eerie scene with the Wolfman. Because going in, you certainly felt the tension, but...
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's like he's choking the scientist and then transforms back into Larry. So.
And then I did like the scene between the scientist and Larry when the scientist was telling them, like, you understand this. I'm half evil. Please kill me if I go all evil.
And he did.
Yeah. Man kept his promise.
Yeah. He said, I'll help you in any way possible. And he did. By shooting him twice with a Luger. Homeboy is holding a German issue pistol.
Well, it's supposed to be in Central Europe around.
Yeah.
In those little city states that Germany used to be before the First World War.
Yeah. Where everybody speaks with an English accent, apparently.
Oh, Lionel Atwill's back in this one.
Yeah.
Playing pretty much same guy.
The same guy.
Same guy as he was in Son of Frankenstein, only far less entertaining.
And not so much.
That was the prosthetic arm, not a
prosthetic
not
arm.
A salute
not,
to anybody.
Not Heiling Hitler.
Less than the sum of its parts, I would say, this movie. John Carradine did that thing that bugs me again, where Dracula runs and gets up from things and acts human. You saw him get up from his coffin. Like the actual old man grunting of him. That was covered by the coffin, but you see him getting up, and that bugs me because they didn't do it with Bella.
They didn't even do that with Carlo Rivera?
Yeah.
Spanish Dracula.
But it bugs me when they do it with John Carradine, because Dracula is not supposed to be human. He's supposed to be barely masquerading as human, and it affects the audience's impression of him so much. And Bella knew that and would act with his body in such a way that, like, it's like this, he wasn't real, almost.
To be fair, the camera also cut away from the coffin, so you wouldn't see that awkwardness.
But there was still, like, he would get up from the operating table, he would do this, which, you know, Bella's
like, just the straight, like,
like, when you finish with the transfusion, he would do this, which is what humans do, like, to stem the blood. If you were, like, a vampire, like, be like, whatever. Doink. Pretty much. Like, there was no surrealism to John Carradine's performance. He was incredibly arresting.
Except a couple of moments, right. But the rest of the time he was just like, I am a patient under your care, Mr. Doctor.
He would sit like this in a chair, and I'm like, no, Dracula would not sit like that if he sat at all. Like, there was like, mundaneness creeping into John Carradine's performance, and half of that was directing, and half of that was acting, and half of that was the angles the camera chose to film.
I'll say, too, that Lon Chaney Jr. kind of also was a little more on the melodramatic side of things.
He's gotten slightly more melodramatic with every portrayal.
With every portrayal of Talbot. I can only imagine what's going to happen. Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein. Jeez. At least we're going to be laughing at that intentionally.
Intentionally.
So, you didn't draw today. Horrifying then? Parts of it.
Parts of it. Parts of it were actually genuinely creepy.
Yeah. Parts were creepy. Horrifying now? I mean, I would barely give this a recommendation. Just out of morbid curiosity.
If you're interested in the monsters as a whole, like, as a monster mash, it's decent. I actually prefer this over House of Frankenstein.
What?
I think it
House of Frankenstein was so much more fun!
It was a lot more fun, but like, purely in how the monsters fit together. I enjoy watching House of Frankenstein more, but this one makes more internal sense to me, if that makes sense. I would call it an interesting film.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, check it out if you're morbidly curious. It's not terrible, but it's
not essential.
Yeah.
Not essential like House of Frankenstein.
But we're done with the Dracula set.
Yay!
Yay! Moving on to...
What's next week?
If you like this video, click on our faces to subscribe, hit the like button or dislike button, comment. What do you think of these little sketches that we're doing at the beginning, right toward the end of this shindig that we're doing?
Late in the game idea. Also, don't forget to check out our Patreon if you've got a couple bucks to spare every month.
What did we watch last time?
Last time was a mummy movie.
Oh yeah, Mummy's Curse. Another kind of whimper of an ending. Yeah. Yeah.
What's next time?
Next time is She-Wolf of London.
Oh boy.
Because we have a good track record with Wolves of London.
It's okay. We'll survive. We will survive.
Click things, please.
Click all the things.